All right. So welcome. Thanks, you guys, for coming out this early in the morning. We don't really have too many announcements, except... No, we don't have any announcements. We do, however, have some swag to reward you for coming out. But this one's too heavy for me to throw, so you have to answer a question, which is...
Yes. Do you know what feature of a file format lifts it to context sensitivity? Do you know which feature of any file format of your choice lifts it to context sensitivity?
If it does.
Do we accept Windows?
Good. The other ones, anyone want to be a designated thrower? How far can you throw, Falcon?
I can throw worth anything.
Go this way! And we'll put this one this way. All right.
We'll give you the answer to that question during the talk, I promise.
Yeah. It's probably good that you're here if you didn't know the answer to that question. So it is my privilege this morning to introduce to you our speakers. We have Falcon here, who is a penetration tester for Leviathan Security. He's also a grad student at Athabasca University. And he's actually presenting with Sergey because they got into an argument at LangSecCon, and it resulted in the collaboration you're going to see today. Sergey is, many of you may be aware of him, professor at Dartmouth, a longtime shining light in the language security community. One of the first people to actually present language security stuff at a HackerCon, and we're very glad to have him. There was something else you wanted to say? That if their slides go on too long, you're supposed to listen faster. I'll let them begin. Go ahead. Right. Please welcome the speakers.
Thank you. So this is going to be a very fast-paced talk, hopefully, or else we run out of slides, or time, or both. This started at our LangSec workshop in San Jose last May, where we had a panel. The point of the panel was, how can we help? How can we help code auditors quantify what is it that gives them a bad feeling about code? Because, I mean, most of you have seen parser code, and you've known that you've known right away would be trouble. But what can you do about that? A bad feeling is not a finding. So we started developing this kind of a approach and checklist for how can you characterize the formats and the code patterns, or rather anti-patterns, that are that result in horrible parser security. And so this is the talk. You judge how useful it is. So first, LangSec is this simple insight that the complexity of your input language is the doom, is the fate of your parser. And the security game is already lost when your input language is too complex. And situations like those that you have with OpenSSL are not the fault of programmers being not careful enough. They are the fault of the format leaving them way too many opportunities for screwing up. Now, we apply a bit of theory to that. We will try to keep this as light as possible. We want to focus instead on how you write and review parsers for that kind of weakness. I speak from the, this is how these vulnerabilities manifest point of view. Falcon speaks from the point of view of how one finds them.
Right. So the first thing that really is important to remember about what we're doing here with language theoretic security is that you and I both know that we can't find every single bug. Finding bugs one by one is just not a workable strategy. There will be more of them and more of them and more of them. So what we need is a strategy for how we can mitigate them from a software engineering standpoint or from a design standpoint before they even have an opportunity to exist. And that's what we're doing here today. Specifically with regard to parsers, this isn't a general theory, unfortunately, of software exploitability, but it certainly does mitigate a lot of things, and we have a very large number of examples of these things that we'll get into later. So what we're doing is we're confirming departures from safe design practices, and we're also defining what those safe design practices are going to be with respect to parsers. And our hope is that penetration testers, like myself and like many of you, will be able to simply call out, well, this is a little bit of a departure from what we know how to implement safely. And so if possible, maybe we can design around not having this level of complexity in our input language. We also currently don't have any practical framework other than what we're going to present here, to be frank, for evaluating the safety of parsers. And so we introduce one.
So, but what we want is CWEs, weaknesses that you can actually refer to as a finding that would allow you to say that this is trouble. This parser is trouble. This code is, this data format is trouble. This protocol spec is trouble. And when we were talking about this, Falcon said, well, I want a finding that would allow me to hold a release host. So for some protocols, you don't want that. If your XML input is just a few objects that do not need to nest, you are probably overusing the power of that language if you allow infinite nesting of those elements. Context sensitivity comes when you create relationships between different objects that you somehow nest in the different branches of your parse tree. And finally, when you give yourself the task of, is this code good or bad? Is this code benign and safe to run, or is it malicious? Then you're pretty much in the Turing complete territory, and you've set yourself a security problem that you cannot really solve. So again, think of a very simple parse tree. Think of a tree that just expands in a given pattern, a finite number of steps without that kind of red cross object references. If you avoid those references, you'll get regular. Now, with context tree, if you allow infinite nesting, if you allow nesting to any given depth and beyond, you've got, but without those red lines, again, you get yourself a context tree grammar. With those, you most likely get yourself a context sensitive grammar. The worst thing you can do in a format is to create circular dependencies between the nodes of your parse tree. In that case, you're just subscribing yourself to a bunch of vulnerabilities.
Right, and this is where we start to take this formalism that Sergey was describing to us and that I was alluding to earlier and really bring it to bear on our ability to find bugs. So what I did in the preparation for this talk is I just went through the MITRE CVE database and I looked for various things, keyword by, did we find a circular reference? Do we have arbitrary recursion in our file format? This is the sort of thing where, you know, you have a hierarchical chain, but then it cross-references back to an earlier point in the hierarchy, and you end up with your parser suddenly generating an infinitely large tree based on a finite-sized document. And so you can just go through this list of CVEs, and you can find constantly DOS at best, stack overflows and looping back in at worst, all kinds of undefined behavior results when you allow your file formats to describe this kind of infinite recursion. And this sort of denial of service vulnerability is kind of a huge problem in the web sort of world today, because you can give this file to a worker and then it suddenly causes that worker to exhaust system memory and spin forever. It can really break your resource utilization sort of paradigm. So anyway, this falls back to the theoretical standpoint. For those that are familiar at all with theory of computation, we can write a recognizer. It terminates on accept. It'll accept the format that doesn't have these cycles. That's a valid document. But when we get up into these higher levels of the Chomsky hierarchy and document complexity, we have a recognizer, but we do not have a decider. And a decider is what terminates when the message is invalid as well. So this sort of structure, these cycles that we're trying to banish by remaining in the deterministic context free or less complex space, this decider is what we're trying to guarantee the presence of, so that if the message is invalid, our execution will somehow terminate and do so in a defined manner.
So again, we're not giving you the proper definitions, and I'm really sorry for that. It would be a very different kind of a lecture if we were. But we want you to look at a format and think of these classes as approximately things that nest in a finite to a finite depth in patterns, regular, balanced, nested parentheses or tags, that is usually context-free. And then any cross-references between the branches of the parse tree lift you to context sensitivity. This is where you set yourself up for my parser will need to check all of these dependencies, and what if I forget one? There is a worse thing that you can do. You can set yourself up for solving the problem of, is this thing, which is equivalent to code, say bytecode, or a smart contract, which turned out to be not so smart for the DAO.
We'll get into that.
Frank, right, which we will talk about. So there, you have a theoretical result that there is no generic algorithm to judge it. You have to run it. In order to find out what it does, you have to expose yourself to whatever it is that it does. And this is just not a proposition that you want to handle. So we want input validation to be the step that protects the rest of your program. For that reason, it must be validating a property that predicts what the rest of the program is doing, that judges what the input will do on the rest of your program. For that, the format should be precisely defined and judgeable with a simple, auditable program. So this is the idea. We want to translate this idea into, or rather departures from that idea, into a bunch of CWEs. Now, you've got the CWEs such as improper input handling, which really doesn't help you much. What is proper, right? You have a CWE that is an indicator of poor code quality. Again, how much does it help? What is the indicator of poor code quality or poor format quality in a parser? So what we're going to present is a complement to the existing CWEs that answer those questions. So what's wrong with the existing CWEs?
Yeah, essentially what we have here is a problem where we have zeroed in with our existing frameworks on something that isn't the root cause, but rather what is the mechanism of these vulnerabilities. So all of these CWEs say things like the input isn't properly neutralized, the input isn't properly sanitized. In our view, this is not the right way to go about it. What we need to do is to make sure that it's very easy to sanitize and correctly validate these inputs. And then we simply won't have these sorts of piecemeal approaches where we find one by one, we can't allow this character, this structure. We need to have checking for cycles in our parser state here and there. Rather, we mean to move up one level of extraction and say, this format should be dead simple to implement and should be implementable in a way that we know, as long as it actually complies with that format as it's written, is perfectly safe. So we'll get into this a little bit later, but the chiefest problem that I see with the existing classification and taxonomy around these problems and the way that we're approaching them is you have to go every single time all the way to the proof of the vulnerability before you can make any change to your format, before you can point out a specification level bug. And so we're going to get in later, I promise, to a list of things that you can simply follow that will prohibit these bugs from having meaning in the first place.
Besides, consider that when you say that your weakness is improper input neutralization, you're already talking about the consequence of the bad design, not a way to spot the bad design. This is what we want to change. And so, again, what is the good of input validation that we want to make proper? And everyone tells you to validate your inputs. The problem with that advice is that you can download a perfectly valid C program, compile it, and run. So you validated it, and you're pwned. So what's the point of input validation? What does it help you do? So the point is that after the implied point that almost no one talks about is that valid implies safe. Valid implies predictable. So the rest of your program, after you've provided your validation, will not give you any surprises. Now, this is a judgment that your parser passes on the data. And this judgment is about the behavior of the rest of the code on that data. You get this intuition from the use of the word neutralization. So data is something active, something that should be rendered inert to be safe. It reflects the fact that every input is something that drives your state, drives your execution, drives your program. Every input is a program. You are judging programs. This is what your input validity is about. So your code assumes things. You can't write code that's all preconditions and preconditions of preconditions and preconditions of preconditions. You have to actually do the work at some point. You have to stop being paranoid at some point. If these assumptions do not hold, so you must make assumptions, but if these assumptions do not hold, no matter how you check your code, it will do something unexpected. It may, in fact, do something Turing complete unexpected, as return-oriented programming, or as we've shown, you can compile just about any program into things like elf and dwarf metadata. So it looks kind of like this. You've checked your code, and your code is correct and tested, and maybe even proven correct for this precondition. But what if what you get to it violates this precondition? Well, you're not getting your guaranteed outcome, your guaranteed result. You're getting something else. So there is this kind of snaky thing that passes through your code. It amplifies it. It becomes a dragon, which we know as the Turing machine, the machine that is owned by your attacker. So your only hope of protecting yourself from that is enforcing those preconditions on the input data with a hardened recognizer that only passes friendly input, right? And then you have to do it in every layer. If you don't do that at the boundary of every layer, then you're probably screwed because, yes, your packet can be perfectly valid IP and TCP, but it carries a payload, an application payload, that exploits you, that violates your assumptions, that gets away with your program. So this is the pattern that we want to see at every communication boundary. There is a specification of what is valid. There is the recognizer that is a program, a piece of your program, a module of your program that judges it, rejects invalid ones, passes in the valid ones, and then the rest of your program only sees the well-typed objects, no raw inputs, and there's a clear boundary of when this happens. If you don't see that, you see violations. You see anti-patterns that you want to spot and report. And we're going to go through these seven turrets of the Tower of Babel one by one, somewhat speeding towards the end. But again, we want to stress that these are findable, these are describable, these are ways to spot trouble.
So basically, the first thing to remember about this taxonomy is that each vulnerability that we found tended to fall into at least one of these categories. But the purpose of these categories is that if you do all of these things correctly, all of the bugs that we're going to cite as examples in this are simply unimplementable. They could not happen. And that's the real power of this taxonomy. So what we want to do is we're currently in the process of getting together some documentation to try and get MITRE to issue CWEs for all of those things so that you can use code analysis techniques that we already have to detect those problems and then remove them, and then all of these bugs that we cite that previously had to be found one by one will simply go away. So I'll let Sergey talk about the first one, shotgun parsers, and then we'll move into the others.
So a shotgun parser is probably the most deadly of these patterns. This is the pattern in which you mix your input validation code and your processing code. So you fire a cloud of checks randomly distributed in a shotgun pattern through your code and hope that they catch all the badness somehow. This doesn't work. This is the worst idea. You are never sure which assumptions you have checked, which assumptions you are checking, and which assumptions you are yet to check. When you see parsers like this, so consider, can you tell what assumption about the code, about the input, this code is checking? Can you tell from this what is it that you expect to find? And the answer is no, and this is your heartbleed, which was a very simple parser bug. You have nested data structures. The outer one has a length. The inner one has a length as well. These lengths must correspond. You've created a cross-reference between these two objects, which you need to assert is true, which you need to assert matches up, which the code didn't do. Because when you see code like this, this is a fix. This is a fix, right? It was a shotgun parser. It remained a shotgun parser despite the fix. So when you have two lengths, which one do you trust? And as it turned out, you trusted the inner one, which then gave you all the memory within 64 kilobyte run after your heartbeat message. But this is not really a fix. This is still an anti-pattern. Just look at this. One and two and, 16, what are these things? What do they reflect on? How do they describe the input? They do not. And then, of course, you're doing this. You're reaching in for unvalidated input. And you can say that you're doing this for speed or for simplicity or for some other reason. But really what you're buying is an endless source of trouble, and an endless source of bugs. So shotgun parsers are probably the deadliest pattern, and very iconic at that. There are subtler things that you can do wrong. Again, you can, if you don't understand that your validity is about predictability, and your checking is about being able to predict that behavior, then you are the DAO.
So I'll speak to this example a little bit. Now, it's important to remember, too, that if you follow this, speaking to performance, your validation actually becomes simpler, and you may find that it is faster to process a protocol that is architected correctly than it is to try and deal with all of these sorts of edge case validation and cycle detection that you would need to do if your protocol was more complicated. So the Ethereum DAO problem is actually one of my favorite examples of why it is so incredibly important that we follow this, making sure that our input language is no more powerful than deterministic context-free. On background, the Ethereum cryptocurrency was designed with a Turing-complete smart contract language explicitly. It's something that I view very, very similar to XSS or SQL injection as a feature within this framework. You just can't do this. And the reason that you can't do this is basically the exact same reason that the DAO, the Decentralized Autonomous Organization, was robbed. So this example that we have on the slide here is not exactly what happened, but it is a reduction of the type of coding pattern in a smart contract using smart contract-like syntax that allowed the DAO to be robbed. What happens here is that you have general recursion. So on this line, I believe it is 11 and 12, right? It actually, on line 11, calls your wallet function, which then you've constructed a malicious wallet that on line 31 calls back in the withdraw function, and it never actually reaches line 13 where it deducts your balance. Now, what is that? Is that a single missing check? We say probably not. Now, the real problem here is that you have to run the contract to figure out what it's going to do, because it has general recursion, and trying to find out in advance of running it and executing it whether it has general recursion is actually just the same thing as the halting problem. It's very expensive to even come to a heuristic solution of this, and you know, who knows what other edge cases someone might be able to find to get around your validation. And so you have to be very careful when you're designing protocols that have these sorts of things, and you would have to be so careful that we propose you can't actually do it at all. If this cryptocurrency had not made this design decision to implement a Turing-complete smart contract language, smart contracts effectively being input, it would have been possible to validate this and this problem of general recursion being included implicitly in the smart contract language could never have happened.
So you really, really do not want to set yourself up in the position where you need to solve the halting problem. I will quote Nicholas Weaver that you don't win cyber wars by solving the halting problem. You win cyber wars by making the other guy solve the halting problem. And you really don't want to be the other guy. Here's another anti-pattern, which is close to the second, but not the same. Every now and then, you see people having their input handling code use a safe subset of something which is a lot more powerful. This doesn't work. If you expose general evaluation as your input handling mechanism, then somebody will find a way to exercise the full power of it. If you put in reflection, evaluation, anywhere near inputs, you are going to get pwned. Essentially, the input handling code that makes the judgment that something is valid or not should be exactly as powerful as the format, but no more powerful. So here is the groovy script of vulnerability. Elasticsearch had this great idea. Oh, we'll let users write search scripts in Ruby. This is cool. You know, we like our users. We trust our users. Of course, what it turned out is that they thus exposed a JVM reflection. And the result was this thing called Elastic Shell. And I blacked out a couple of words down there. But yeah. So if you expose something which is a generic execution engine and hope that the attackers would not use the full power of it, you're mistaken. Ruby on Rails had this issue. What was that issue? Well, we can eval input, right? Why parse it? I mean, parsing is boring. Let's just take a string of Ruby and eval it and construct all the objects that we want. So this kind of issue started back in 2012. It keeps going on till 2016. The latest one, here's the proposed mitigation. Mitigate by casting the parameter to a string in active record. So what is this? Your parameter is already an object, an evaluated object. How do you judge that thing? I mean, when people said, don't let YAML load close to any user input, they were exactly right. Let me translate this for you. Don't leave generic evaluation mechanisms anywhere close to user input. So it's quite bad. The classic example, of course, is shell shock. When your CGI ends up taking input from the friendly internets and then passing it to a function called parse and execute, you know you're in for trouble. And of course, it was said that Bash found itself with a pounding headache on the pirate ship shell drop, being impressed into service as a drunken sailor. Here's a problem. As an auditor, if you see something that looks like a generic execution mechanism sitting close to the input, you should report it. That sort of a, we'll use this subset and we'll hold our inputs only to that subset, and hopefully the inputs will not get at the rest of the rich interpreter. This is an anti-pattern. This is a bad, bad design. Having said that, of course, your recognizer must be equal to the input language in its power. I absolutely love this Stack Overflow answer. The question is, how can I parse HTML with regexps? So find an automaton brought to bear on something that allows infinite nesting, context-free format. And the answer is, you can't parse. You can't parse. You shouldn't parse. This is not the right tool. Oh my God, you know, it's tentacles everywhere. I'm losing my mind.
It's simply beyond the describability, right, of a finite automaton. The finite automaton sees infinity, and it's just over. So for those that don't have a theoretical background, we want to discuss a little bit, why is that? Well, try to write a regex that matches nested parens. Try to write a regex that matches this very common idiom that we have in most web development where you have a lot of diffs. And you'll find that what you have to do is you need to add an additional state, or you need to add another little segment to your regular expression, you know, div question mark, another back reference that's enumerated. You'll find that your parser would have to grow infinitely. And so really, you can't write one that is general. You must use something context-free. And what this means, that what we say is that this nesting lifted us into context-free grammar. So you really need to make sure that your validator is powerful enough to validate the language that you're needing to evaluate, with the understanding that when you do so, now you have exposed that context-free grammar, that pushdown automaton, to your attacker, and it's much more powerful. It has greater odds of having a weird machine in it.
Yeah, think of it this way. If you have a regexp, what you're exposing is a finite state machine. So your attacker is manipulating finite state. When you are dealing with context-free grammar, you're using a stack. So now your adversary is manipulating something that has a stack. The more complexity you pile in, the more your adversary will be able to manipulate.
So let's look at this very simple specification that I made just for the purposes of illustration here. All right, very simple. We're passing names and length of names, and if there isn't a length, then the name has to be signed so that we can make sure that it's legitimate and won't overflow memory or something. Okay, so here's a valid message that conforms with my specification. It has a name length and it has a name. Well, why isn't this valid? Oops. So you can say, well, we need to have an additional check now for namelen, but you didn't specify that. So now we're stuck, and someone has implemented our protocol, and it sent out a message like this. Well, okay, but we can kind of still figure out what this message is supposed to mean, right? I mean, obviously the name is so long, and one of these parameters is wrong, so can't we just discard it? That's actually a huge anti-pattern that we'll get into a little bit later. But what that does is it complexifies your parser, and it changes it into something that transforms invalid input to valid input that has a meaning that's not precisely certain. And that can be very dangerous. We'll get into some bugs that were related to that in just a little bit. Now, that also, what I just mentioned, was a little bit of the Postel principle, right? Be very liberal in what you accept. We advocate right now patching that out a little bit. That's actually very dangerous, because if we accept this obviously valid message, then chances are we also do something with this less valid message. Maybe we take the first one, maybe we take the last one. Who knows whether we have the bug or not? You don't really need to accept this message, do you? If you specify your protocol correctly, then you can simply discard this packet, and it will be the implementation that sent it that is buggy, which is the correct locus of where that bug should be. If you must accept it, then you have to specify the way in which you expect it. And we'll get into this in a little bit when we do the checklist. But you have to account for edge cases in your specification. You cannot process them implicitly, because that just gives power to your attacker, and it yields differing implementations. Another thing that I wanted to point out here at this juncture is, simply using a common interchange format, such as JSON or XML or ASN.1, God forbid, won't help us with this problem. This packet is perfectly valid JSON. It's not valid in our protocol. this looks a little bit like something else, actually, that we were just talking about. And so we can see that the complexity of these languages is not closed under the addition of additional constraints. Remembering our diagram from before, sure, JSON sits in this context-free place because it has balanced matching brackets. It has nested structures. But subsets of JSON might be anything. You can define a subset of JSON that is potentially regular if you don't follow all of JSON. You can define a subset of JSON that is unrestricted, and nothing can actually parse that. They're telling us that we have 5 minutes remaining, so we'll have to go through this very quickly here. So additional constraints can also lift the language. This is another problem I won't explain in any great detail, but it looks rather a lot like Android Master Key. We don't know whether we parse the first signature or the last signature. So what are we going to do with this?
We had this problem. We had this problem before. When you have two parsers and they disagree on what the message is, you've broken your security scheme. This has happened with X509. This has happened with Android signing. We will leave you the full story in the paper, but what you want to look for when you have two parsers or more is that they are equivalent. The harder, the more complex your format, the harder it is to validate this. Yet another anti-pattern is incomplete specification. If you do not specify what is valid and what is not, what are your assumptions? How can you check them? How can you construct the testing and the proof that your program is correct? You've just doomed the rest of your program to behaving unpredictably on some of these. This has happened, again, in the name of extensibility of protocols. They have left pieces of it underspecified, such as what kind of characters do you allow in a common name? Bad idea. Some of some parsers will see the high-value name. Some parsers will see the low-value name. Underspecification is an anti-pattern. So,
yeah, what we need to do is we need to first and foremost make sure that our specifications are fully specified and easy to implement. So one of my examples of a language that is hard to implement is one that includes 64-bit unsigned integers. JVM languages have a little funniness around this, and so if you don't need to specify things that are so general, it's perfectly all right to add a few additional constraints just to account for the realities of implementing infinite machines. The other thing that we advocate for here is this little bolded patch to the Postel principle that we propose. If you have an invalid message, you need to reject it immediately in the parsing stage. I want to not spend too much time on that because we have it in our checklist, which I'm going to have to go through in a little bit here. We also have this problem with overloaded fields, whereby we have a similar syntactic ambiguity. NTP, for example, has a particular value for its crypto key identifier handle, which means authentication not required. This was used, essentially, by somebody to impersonate a stratum one-time source, simply because the parser was confused about what context it was in when. So we say, when you're specifying protocols, please, if you have some special case like this, generate an extra field for it. You can afford the extra byte, and it's going to make your implementation vastly simpler to deal with. As well, in the same vein, many, many things try to transform input, like we were talking about before with that kind of contrived protocol. Reject that input. Don't fix that input. This is a slightly long road, but it is one that will pay a great deal of dividends, and probably the strongest example in advocacy of this that we can find is when IE8 had the XSS filter that would constantly activate XSS vulnerabilities, or PDF rewriting by Adobe Acrobat essentially resulting in undefined behavior. Postel's robustness principle is trouble. Rewriting is something that can activate previously inert data that goes through a web application firewall just fine into something that is malicious. So it really, we view as an anti-pattern. So these, again, just for review, are our CWEs. We started 10 minutes late, so it's a little bit rushed. But from these, I derive the following checklist. This is fairly long. I hope I have time to get through all of it. But the first one is, we intend to mitigate shotgun parsing by answering these very simple falsifiable questions. Is the parser a discrete stage of the application? Does it parse and then do its logic? Or does it do a little logic and then branch back into the parsing? If you can, try and at least raise something informational to say, please, try and transform this so that you have made your decision about whether or not this is a syntactically valid thing before we get into actually processing it. Because if not, then you have to answer the question of what happens on partially parsed data, and that's very hard to do correctly. Do we make allocation decisions, authorization decisions before it's done? Remember my length field. If we allocated a space of size 4 when we saw initially our length was 4, then we wouldn't be able to validly parse the message and we would have a heap overflow. So we need to get rid of these things at the design level, and the way that we do it is by having a gate that ensures that we've parsed the message fully before we proceed. There's an opportunity here to develop tooling around this, and I highly recommend reading Katie's paper because it describes exactly how this tool would look. To automatically use taint tracking to define shotgun parsers. We'll publish these slides and the link will be clickable. Another one is, how do we tell that input is not greater than deterministic context-free? Well, when you find cross-references in an input that don't follow a hierarchical chain, please flag them. Because that is where these opportunities for cycle and the litany of vulnerabilities comes from. You don't need to prove out that there's general recursion, in my humble opinion, to point out the fact that the protocol is not specified in a way that would ensure it's not there. We also need to make sure, of course, that there aren't general purpose scripting languages in our input. So if you find that JavaScript executed by the application that's reading the file is allowed, or there are Groovy scripts, consider revising. Consider making a domain-specific language for this program's input that is less complex. Is input allowed to dictate the schema? We all know that in XML parsers, we have to constantly disable external document type inclusions. Generalize that. Any time that you see it's pulling the schema from an external source or trusting the schema from a client, ask a lot of questions. And of course, when input rewrites itself, as in with XML entities, this is a huge locus of bugs. Respecting non-minimalist input handling, we need to make sure that we check whether the parser does anything more than just validate input. That would effectively make it a shotgun parser, by the way. You can see how these are all intertwined. See that it doesn't depend on external resources for its validity. See that it doesn't have more features than are strictly necessary for its use case. See as well that with respect to parser differentials, does it depend on platform features? Because if it does depend on platform features, then will result in parser differentials when data transfers from one platform to another. Ensure you consider the representation, not just maximum sizes. With respect to the incomplete specifications, we need to make sure that we specify everything. Don't support anything that's not in the specification. If you find the need to support a bug, add it to the specification. That is the original purpose of how we developed internet standards. We need to make sure that we continue doing that, because otherwise we get weird surprises, like what we were mentioning before with libnss. Libnss, who knew that it supported regular expressions in CNs, and that was the locus of a heap overflow bug. Overloaded fields as well, see that it doesn't treat any message specially. This is very simple, we don't need to belabor it. See that the program doesn't accept things that it knows will violate the standard. See that it doesn't do transformations. These are all falsifiable questions. These are all things that you can evaluate discreetly.
And these all should be findings.
Yes.
These should hold a release hostage. And we hope to create the ammunition for you to do so. I think we'll skip through the rest.
We'll post these slides online. We highly recommend reading them. We just need to make sure that we use these things when penetration testing, and also build tools, dig into anything that violates these constraints, and we'll find that there will be a considerable benefit in terms of simplifying the process of both developing and of testing these applications.
There is a paper. It's free online. Do this. Do not deviate from this. Otherwise, you will be granting the insides of your program to the manipulators of your input, and you will have your attackers actually programming weird machines inside your code. Come join us for the LangSec workshop in May. We're planning to have a hackathon in which we would ask people to implement better parsers with better tools. If you're interested, check out the website, reach out. We'd love to have you playing the defense as well as the auditing game. We're out of time. We started a bit late, but thank you for your patience.
No time for questions, I guess.
Nope. Yeah. It's 5 minutes to 11, right? We need to see the podium.
So if you have questions for this wonderful presentation, please meet with the authors outside in the hallway.
Yeah, are you Jason?
Yeah.
All right, go ahead and get set up, and I'll do your introduction in just a minute.
Are you going to let people know that Jay couldn't make it?
Yeah, that's my...
So, good morning. If you guys are on your way in to see Jake Williams talk about finding evil in Windows 10, Jake is unable to make it today. Instead, we have two talks for the price of one. First, we will have Jason Blanchard talking about how, from the fire talks, how to spoil.